Hello everyone, myself Bismi P. Charyan, assistant professor at Suresh Gyaniha University. Today I'm going to discuss about the chemistry of antihypertensive drugs. The learning objectives of this topic is this lesson will help the students to understand the mechanism of action and the uses of the antihypertensive agents. Learning outcomes: after this lesson, students will be able to understand or describe the ACR mechanism of action, the uses of antihypertensive agents. So before going to the topic, means antihypertensive agents, we have to know what is hypertension. So hypertension is defined as a physiological condition where there is an increase in the arterial blood pressure above normal. Okay, so hypertension is the condition where the arterial blood pressure is increases. Okay, so the normal blood pressure is 120 bar 80 mmHg. Okay, and an individual is hypertensive when the BP is greater than or above the 140 bar 90. Okay, so the normal range of BP is 120 bar 80, but if a person having the BP is greater than 140 bar 90, so he is a hypertensive patient. So hypertension is the condition in which the arterial blood pressure is increases. Hypotension, so this is the condition, increase in the arterial blood pressure is the hypotension. So let's see what is hypotension. So hypotension may be defined as the physiological state where there is a decrease in BP than the normal. So normal BP range is 120 by 80. So below that range is hypotension. Okay, and above 140 bar 90 is the hypertension. So hypotension is the condition where there is a decrease in BP than the normal. An individual is said to be hypotensive when the BP is lower than 90 bar 60. Okay, so normal BP is 120 bar 80, and where if the BP is 90 by 60, so that person is hypotensive patient. Hypertension is divided into two types. Okay, hypertension is divided into two types: primary hypertension or the essential hypertension, and the secondary hypertension or the malignant hypertension. So hypertension is divided into two types: primary hypertension, that is also known as the essential hypertension, and the secondary hypertension or the malignant hypertension. So there is a increase in pressure, that is called as hypertension. If there is a lower blood pressure than the normal, that is called as hypotension. The normal range of the blood pressure is 120 by 80. Above 140 by 90 is hypertension. Below 90 by 60 is hypotension. And the hypertension is divided into two types: primary hypertension as well as and the secondary hypertension. Primary hypertension is known as essential hypertension, and the secondary hypertension is known as malignant hypertension. In the primary or essential hypertension, in majority of the cases where etiology is unknown. Okay, so the etiology is unknown in the primary or the essential hypertension, and that is caused unknown cause, and is known as the primary hypertension. Where the etiology is unknown cause, that is known as primary or essential hypertension. The following factor may contribute to elevate the BP: dietary intake of more sodium and the less potassium. Okay, if you are taking the more sodium and less potassium, then there is a chance of hypertension. Though so that is known as primary or essential hypertension, means the etiology is unknown. In some cases, primary hypertension may be hereditary. Okay, so the primary hypertension is may be hereditary, means that may be a genetic. Advancement of age means as the age increases, there is a chance of essential hypertension in a patient and in people. Decreased vascular synthesis of nitric oxide. Okay, if the nitric oxide is synthesized in low amount, then also this essential hypertension course. So this is the primary or essential hypertension. So in this primary or essential hypertension, etiology is unknown, and when as the age increases, then chances of primary hypertension as well as the this may be also due to the hereditary, okay, means due to the genetic and due to the intake of more sodium and less potassium, also the cause of the essential hypertension, as well as the decreased vascular synthesis of nitric oxide is also again the cause of the primary or essential hypertension. In secondary hypertension, where the etiology can be identified, okay, so in the secondary hypertension, the etiology can be identified. Secondary hypertension is due to the renal disease, okay, if any patient have any renal disease, so in that case, secondary hypertension may be occur. Means the kidney disorders, chronic glomerular nephritis. So these are the conditions where the secondary hypertension may be occur. Adrenal disease. Okay. Second is adrenal disease, that is endocrine disorders. In that case, also this secondary hypertension may be occur. Pheochromocytoma, that is tumor on adrenal medulla, which secretes excessive catecholamines like adrenaline and noradrenaline. Okay, so in this case, again, the secondary hypertension may be occur. Muscular disease, contraction of aorta, okay, narrowing of aorta and renal artery stenosis means narrowing of the arteries, toxemia of pregnancy, presence of toxin in the bloodstream, encephalitis, that is inflammation of the brain, increased intracranial pressure. So these all are the conditions where the secondary hypertension may be occur. Okay, and if the oral contraceptives is taken by any people, so in that case also this secondary hypertension may be occur. So there is a hypertension is divided into two part. So first is essential hypertension, second is secondary hypertension or the malignant hypertension. In the essential hypertension, the etiology is unknown, but the secondary hypertension that is associated with some diseases, okay, or some medicines, means oral contraceptives and all. And the primary or essential hypertension that may be occur due to the more intake of the sodium and less intake of the potassium. And this is due to the genetic or maybe hereditary. And as the age increases, there's a chance of essential hypertension. And decreased vascular synthesis of the nitric oxide is again the chance of, is the reason for the primary hypertension. And the hypertension BP is the normal range of the BP is 120/80 and hypertension is above 140/90 is the hypertension, and 90/60 below the 90/60 is the hypotension. Causes of the hypertension, okay, so that may be due to the increase in the age, hypertension may be caused. 95% of hypertension is unknown, means etiology is unknown. Arterial disease, okay, and if any patient having the arterial disease, in that case, in that patient, the hypertension may be occur. Oversynthesis of the hormone is the another cause of the hypertension. Okay, oversynthesis of the hormone is another cause of the hypertension. Drugs, alcohol, liquorice. Okay, if any patient is taking any drugs, alcohol, the liquorice, that is again the cause of the hypertension. Genetic factor is another cause of the hypertension. And if the patient having any renal disease, that again the causes of the hypertension. In that patient also the hypertension chances are increased. Classification of the classification means the category of the hypertension. Normal, pre-hypertension, stage 1 hypertension, stage 2 hypertension. Stage 1 hypertension is known as mild hypertension. Stage 2 hypertension is known as moderate hypertension. Stage 3 is severe hypertension. Stage 4 is very severe hypertension. So 120 is systolic blood pressure, 80 is diastolic blood pressure. Okay. So in the pre-hypertension, the systolic blood pressure ranges between 121 to 139 and the diastolic blood pressure ranges between 81 to 89. And stage 1 mild hypertension, in this case, the systolic blood pressure ranges between 140 to 159 and the diastolic blood pressure ranges between 90 to 99. In the stage two hypertension, that is moderate hypertension, in this the systolic blood pressure ranges between 160 to 179. The diastolic blood pressure ranges between 100 to 109. And the in the stage three, the severe hypertension, the systolic blood pressure ranges between 180 to 209, and the diastolic blood pressure ranges between 110 to 119. Stage four or very severe hypertension, in that case, the severe blood pressure, systolic blood pressure ranges means that is above 210, and the diastolic blood pressure is above 120. So this is too much. So this is called as very severe hypertension. So this is the classification or the category of the hypertension, and these are the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure according to the category of the hypertension. On etiological basis, hypertension is divided into two types. So the first one is primary hypertension, okay, and the cause is unknown. Following factors may be contribute to elevation of the BP, means that we have already see that means more intake of the sodium and less intake of the potassium is the cause of the primary hypertension. Decrease in the synthesis of the nitric oxide in the vascular, that is again cause the primary hypertension. In some cases, it may be due to the hereditary, means that is genetic. So these are the causes of the primary hypertension. Etiology is unknown. And secondary hypertension, in some cases, hypertension may be secondary to other diseases like endocrine disorders, okay, chronic glomerular nephritis, muscular disorders. So if any patient have some diseases, so that this secondary hypertension is associated with that diseases. If the patient have any kidney disease, so the hypertension is caused due to that disease also. So that is connected to each other. So that is called as secondary hypertension. Let's see some example of the antihypertensive drug. So first drug is timolol. Okay, so the structure of the timolol is this. This is the structure of the timolol. And this drug is non-selective beta adrenergic blockers. Okay, so this is the beta adrenergic blockers that is used in the treatment of elevated intraocular pressure in ocular hypertension or open angle glaucoma. So this timolol is an antihypertensive drug, and this is non-selective beta adrenergic blockers. Okay, non-selective beta adrenergic blockers, and that is used in the treatment of elevated intraocular pressure and in the open angle glaucoma. Let's see the mechanism of action of timolol. So this drug timolol competes with adrenergic neurotransmitters for binding to beta adrenergic receptors in the heart. So this drug competes with adrenergic neurotransmitters for binding to the beta adrenergic receptor in the heart and the beta 2 receptor in the vascular and the bronchial smooth muscle. So in the heart, it competes with the beta 1 adrenergic receptor in the vascular as well as the bronchial smooth muscle, that this drug competes with beta 2 receptors. This leads to diminished action of catecholamines. Okay, when this competition occurs, that leads with diminished or decreased action of the catecholamine, which normally bind to adrenergic receptors and exert sympathetic effects, leading to an increase in the blood pressure and the heart rate. So when this timolol competed with adrenergic neurotransmitters for binding to beta 1 and the beta 2 receptor, that leads to decreased action of the catecholamine that normally bind to the adrenergic receptors and exert a sympathetic effect, leading to an increased blood pressure and the heart rate. Beta 1 receptor blockade by timolol leads to a decrease in both heart rate and the cardiac output during the rest and the exercise. Okay, so this beta 1 receptor blockade by the timolol leads to a decrease in the both heart rate and the cardiac output during rest and the exercise, and a decrease in both systolic and the diastolic blood pressure also. So, okay, so this timolol compete for the beta 1 receptor as well as the beta 2 receptors and decreases the diastolic blood pressure. In addition to this, reduction in the reflex orthostatic hypotension may also occur. Okay, so reduction in reflex orthostatic hypotension may occur. This blockade of beta 2 receptor by timolol in the blood vessels leads to decrease in the peripheral vascular resistance, reducing the blood pressure. Okay, so the blockade of the beta 2 receptor by timolol in the blood vessel, that also decrease in the peripheral vascular resistance, reducing the blood pressure. So this is the mechanism of action of the timolol. So this timolol competes with the adrenergic neurotransmitter for binding to the beta 1 receptor as well as the beta 2 receptor. Beta 1 receptor is in the heart and the beta 2 receptor in the vascular and the bronchial smooth muscle. And that leads to decreased action of the catecholamine, and that is responsible for the increase in the blood pressure. Okay, so when the catecholamine decreases, the heart, the blood pressure decreases. Beta 1 receptor blockade by the timolol leads to a decrease in both heart rate and the cardiac output. Okay, so this timolol, when this bind with the beta 1 receptor, okay, so at that time the heart rate and the cardiac output decreases, and the decrease in both systolic and diastolic blood pressure. Okay, so this timolol, when bind with beta 1 receptor, that decreases the systolic as well as the diastolic blood pressure. In addition, it reduces the reflex orthostatic hypotension may also. In addition, the reduction in the reflex orthostatic, okay, reduction in reflex orthostatic, that leads hypotension. The blockade of the beta 2 receptor by timolol in the blood vessels lead to decrease in the peripheral vascular resistance. Okay, when this drug bind with the beta 2 receptor, that decrease the peripheral vascular resistance and that reduces the blood pressure. Let's see the uses of the timolol. Ophthalmic timolol is indicated for the treatment of increased intraocular pressure in the patient with ocular hypertension or the open-angle glaucoma. So this drug is, we are giving in that patient, those have the ocular hypertension, okay, or open angle glaucoma. So it decreases. So this is used in the treatment of increased intraocular pressure in the patient with ocular hypertension. So the use of the timolol, this is used in the treatment of increased intraocular pressure. Okay, with ocular hypertension and for open angle glaucoma. The oral form of this drug is used to treat high blood pressure. Okay, the ophthalmic timolol is used in the treatment of intraocular pressure in the patient. Okay, and the oral form of this drug is used in the treatment of high blood pressure. In some cases, timolol is also used in the prevention of migraine headache. Okay, so this ophthalmic timolol is indicated in the treatment of increased intraocular pressure, and the oral form of the drug is used in the treatment of high blood pressure. And in some cases, timolol is used in the prevention of migraine headaches. So this is all about the timolol. Next drug is captopril. Captopril is an ACE inhibitor. Okay, so this captopril is an ACE inhibitor that is used for the management of essential or renovascular hypertension, congestive heart failure, left ventricular dysfunction following myocardial infarction and the nephropathy. Okay, so this captopril is an, captopril is an ACE inhibitor. Okay. So this is used in the management of essential or the renovascular hypertension, congestive heart failure, left ventricular dysfunction. Okay, so this is the structure of the captopril. Okay, and this captopril is ACE inhibitor. Okay, the structure of the captopril is this. Sorry. Let's see the mechanism of action of the captopril. The captopril blocks the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Okay, so this what this captopril do? Captopril blocks the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 and prevents the degradation of vasodilatory prostaglandins. Okay, so this captopril blocks the conversion of angiotensin 1 to the angiotensin 2 and that prevent the degradation of vasodilatory prostaglandins, thereby inhibiting the vasoconstriction and promoting systemic vasodilation. Okay, so this captopril, what this captopril do? Captopril block the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 and prevent the degradation of vasodilatory prostaglandins, thereby inhibiting vasoconstriction and the promoting systemic vasodilation. Let's see the uses of this captopril. Captopril is used alone or in combination with other medication to treat high blood pressure and the heart failure. So this captopril we are using in the combination with other medication to treat the high blood pressure as well as the heart failure. So this is about the captopril. So let's see once again what is captopril. Captopril is an IC inhibitor that is used for the management of essential or neurovascular hypertension, congestive heart failure, left ventricular dysfunction following myocardial infarction and the nephropathy. And the mechanism of action of the captopril is captopril blocks the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 and prevent the degradation of vasodilatory prostaglandins, thereby inhibiting vasoconstriction and the promoting systemic vasodilation. And the uses of the captopril is this is used in the treatment of the high blood pressure with combination of some other drugs as well as in the treatment of the heart failure also. This captopril is used in the combination with other medications. Next drug is lisinopril. Lisinopril structure is this. Okay, the benzene ring is here and the carboxylic acid group is here. group is here. So this is the structure of the lisinopril. Lisinopril is again the AC inhibitor. Okay, the captopril, lisinopril, both are the AC inhibitor that is used to treat the hypertension, heart failure, and acute myocardial infarction. Okay, so this lisinopril is again the AC inhibitor that is used in the treatment of the hypertension, heart failure, and the acute myocardial infarction. Mechanism of action, this inhibit, okay, lisinopril inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme in human subjects and the animals. Okay, so this again inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme, that is ACE, angiotensin converting enzyme. So lisinopril inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme in human subjects and the animals. ACE, peptidyl dipeptidase, okay, ACE is a peptidyl dipeptidase that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensin 1 to the vasoconstrictor substance angiotensin 2. And angiotensin 2 also stimulates the aldosterone secretion by the adrenal cortex. So what is this ACE? ACE is the means angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, that is responsible for the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So this is the enzyme. With the help of this enzyme, that angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2. Okay, but this lisinopril, what this do? It inhibit this enzyme. Okay, and this enzyme is a peptidyl dipeptidase. Okay, this enzyme ACE is an enzyme that is peptidyl dipeptidase that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensin 1 to the angiotensin 2. And angiotensin 2 also stimulate the aldosterone secretion by the adrenal cortex. Okay, so this lisinopril inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, and when this enzyme decreases, the angiotensin 2 doesn't form. So this is the mechanism of action of lisinopril, and lisinopril is ACE inhibitor. Captopril also ACE inhibitor that also reduces the conversion of angiotensin 1 to the angiotensin 2. Sorry. Let's see the uses of the lisinopril. Lisinopril is used alone or in the combination with other medication to treat high blood pressure in adults and the children 6 years of age and older. Okay, So this lisinopril is used alone or in combination with other medication too, okay, to treat the high blood pressure in adults as well as the children above the age 6, okay, above the age 6. So this is also, this lisinopril is used in the children as well as the adult, but children should be above 6 years, okay. And it is used in the combination with other medications to treat heart failure. So this lisinopril is used in the combination with other medication also to treat the heart failure. Lisinopril is also used to improve survival after the heart attack. So this lisinopril is used in the treatment of the high blood pressure, and this is also used with other medication to treat the heart failure. Lisinopril is also used to improve survival after a heart attack. So this is the uses, or these are the uses of the lisinopril. And the mechanism of action of lisinopril is, lisinopril reduce the ACE, means angiotensin converting enzyme, okay, that reduce the angiotensin converting enzyme, and due to that reduction, the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 doesn't happen, and that thereby the blood pressure is reduced. And the uses of this lisinoprils are, this is used alone or in the combination of other medication, combination with other medication to treat the high blood pressure as well as the heart failure. Heart failure. And the lisinopril is also used to improve the survival after the heart attack. Next drug is enalapril. Okay, enalapril is a prodrug of an ACE inhibitor. Okay, enalapril is the prodrug, okay, of an ACE inhibitor. Next drug is enalapril. Okay, enalapril is again is a prodrug. Okay, prodrug of an ACE inhibitor used to treat hypertension and the congestive heart failure. Okay, so this captopril, lisinopril, enalapril, these all are the ACE inhibitor. And enalapril is a prodrug of ACE inhibitor that is used in the treatment of hypertension as well as the congestive heart failure. And this is the structure of enalapril. Let's see the mechanism of action. Enalaprilate, okay. Enalaprilate, the active metabolite of enapril, okay. That inhibit the ACE. So, enalaprilate is the active metabolite of enalapril, okay. Enalapril is a prodrug. When the patient take this enalapril, this is converted into enalaprilate. And that decreases the ACE, that is ACE inhibitor, angiotensin converting enzyme, that reduces the angiotensin converting enzyme. Inhibition of ACE decreases the levels of angiotensin 2, okay, and leading to less vasoconstriction and the decreased blood pressure. So this enalaprilate, okay, enalaprilate is the active metabolite of enalapril. Okay, enalapril is the main drug, that is a prodrug. When the patient takes this enalapril, that is converted into the enalaprilate, or that the active metabolite is enalaprilate. That enalaprilate inhibit the ACE, that is angiotensin converting enzyme. That this enalaprilate reduces the angiotensin converting enzyme. So this due to this inhibition of ACE, that decreases the level of angiotensin 2. Okay, when this angiotensin 2 decreases, that that leads to less vasoconstriction and the decreased blood pressure. Okay, so this is the mechanism of action of enalapril. Enalapril is a prodrug of ACE inhibitor. Okay, and the enalaprilate is the active metabolite. Okay, and that decreases the ACE. And due to this decretion or inhibition of ACE, that decreases the level of angiotensin 2. And that leads to less vasoconstriction and the decreased blood pressure. Let's see the uses of this enalapril. Enalapril is a medicine that is used to reduce the high blood pressure and prevent or treat heart failure. So enalapril is used to reduce the high blood pressure and in the treatment of or in to prevent or treat the heart failure, we are using this enalapril drug. Enalapril-8 is the metabolite of enalapril. Okay, and that is responsible for the reduction inhibition of ACE. If you have high blood pressure, taking enalapril will help prevent a future heart attack or stroke. Okay, if any patient having the high blood pressure, okay, and if he or she taking this enalapril drug, that help to prevent the future heart attack and the stroke. So this enalapril is a prodrug. Prodrug of ACE inhibitors, okay, ACE inhibitors, that when this tablet taken by the patient, this is converted into enalaprilate, okay, enalaprilate. After that, enalaprilate reduces the ACE, angiotensin converting enzyme produced by that metabolite, enalaprilate, and due to that inhibition of ACE, that leads to inhibition of level of means angiotensin 2, because this that enzyme is responsible for the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. When this enzyme reduces, that conversion doesn't happen and the level of angiotensin 2 decreases in the body. So due to that, the blood pressure is decreases. Okay, and this enalapril is the medicine that is used in the treatment of blood pressure and to prevent or treat heart failure. Okay, if any patient is taking this, if any patient having the blood pressure, high blood pressure, and he or she taking this enalapril, that will help to prevent the future heart attack and the stroke. So this is all about the enalapril. Benazepril hydrochloride. So benazepril hydrochloride is again the ACE inhibitor product, and that is used to treat the hypertension. Okay, so this benazepril is again the ACE inhibitor, captopril, lisinopril, enalapril, benazepril. So these all are the ACE inhibitor. Okay, these all are the ACE inhibitor. Benazepril is again the prodrug, and this is used in the treatment of hypertension. Mechanism of action. So benazepril and the benazeprilate inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, this is again decreases the ACE. So this benazepril is again the prodrug, and the benazeprilate inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme ACE in the human subject and the animals. ACE is the peptidyl dipeptidase that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Okay, so these all are the ACE inhibitor, and the mechanism of action of every drug that will remain same. Okay, so this benazeprilate is the metabolite of this benazepril. Benazepril is a prodrug. When patient takes this benazepril, it is converted into benazeprilate. Okay, and that inhibit the ACE. That enzyme is inhibited with the help of this benazeprilate. Okay, benazeprilate in the human subject and the animals. And the ACE is the means this angiotensin converting enzyme is a peptidyl dipeptidase that, okay, so this ACE is a peptidyl dipeptidase that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Okay, so this benazepril is a prodrug that is converted into the metabolite benazeprilate. Okay, that benazeprilate inhibit the angiotensin converting enzyme in human subject and the animals. And this ACE is a peptidyl dipeptidase that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Let's see the uses of benazepril. Benazepril is used alone or in the combination with other medication to treat high blood pressure. Okay, so this benazepril is used alone or in combination with other medication to treat high blood pressure. Benazepril is in the class of the medications called angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, so this is a ACE inhibitor. It works by decreasing certain chemicals that tighten the blood vessels and so blood flow more smoothly. So this is used in the treatment of the blood pressure. Okay, so this benazepril we are using in the treatment of blood pressure alone or in the combination with other medications. Next is cunapril hydrochloride. So this is the structure of cunapril hydrochloride. Cunapril is an AC inhibitor prodrug that is used to treat hypertension, congestive heart failure, and the slow rate of progression of renal disease. Okay, so this is again the AC inhibitor. So let's see the mechanism of action. Cunapril is a deesterified to the principal metabolite cunaprilate. Okay, so this cunapril is again converted into the metabolite cunaprilate, that is inhibitor of the ACE activity in the human subject. And this ACE is a peptidyl dipeptidase that catalyzes the conversion of angiotensin 1 to the angiotensin 2. So cunapril is a prodrug that is converted to the cunaprilate, and that this cunaprilate inhibit the ACE, means angiotensin converting enzyme is decreased or inhibited by the cunaprilate. Okay, cunaprilate, and this cunaprilate, this ACE is responsible for the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. When this enzyme is reduced in the body, so the level of angiotensin 2 is again reduced in the body due to the decrease in the ACE, and means angiotensin converting enzyme. So this is the mechanism of action of cunapril. Cunapril reduces or inhibits the ACE in the body, and that ACE is responsible for the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So let's see the uses of this cunapril. Cunapril is used alone or in the combination with other medication to treat high blood pressure. Okay, so this cunapril is used alone or in the combination with other medication to treat high blood pressure. It is used in the combination with other medication to treat heart failure. Okay, so this is also used in the blood pressure as well as to treat the heart failure. Cunapril is a class of the medication called angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, so this cunapril decreases the ACE, means angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, that decreased by the cunaprilate, that is a metabolite of the cunapril. And this is used alone or in the combination with the other medication to treat the high blood pressure and to treat the heart failure. Sorry. Next drug is methyl dopate hydrochloride. Okay, methyl dopate hydrochloride. Let's see, this is the structure of methyl dopate hydrochloride. So in the syllabus, the synthesis of methyl dopate hydrochloride we have to learn. So the mechanism of action, first we have to see what is the mechanism of action of methyl dopa. So this methyl dopa converts its metabolite. Okay, it converts its metabolite. Methyl dopa converts its metabolite alpha methyl norepinephrine. Okay, norepinephrine, which stimulates the centrally inhibitory alpha adrenergic receptors. Okay, so this methyl dopa that converts its metabolite, that is alpha methyl norepinephrine, okay, and that stimulates the centrally inhibitory alpha adrenergic receptors. Okay, this metabolite stimulates the central inhibitory alpha adrenergic receptors. It leads to reduction in sympathetic tone, blood pressure, and the total peripheral resistance. Okay, so when this stimulate the central inhibitory alpha adrenergic receptors, that reduce in the sympathetic tone and blood pressure and the total peripheral resistance. Inhibition of decarboxylation of dihydroxyphenylalanine, that is DOPA. Okay, inhibition of decarboxylation of dihydroxyphenylalanine and 5-hydroxytryptophan in the CNS, which produces the antihypertensive effects. Okay, so when this decarboxylation of dihydroxyphenylalanine decreases and the 5-hydroxytryptophan decreases, means decarboxylation of these two decreases in the CNS, that produce the antihypertensive effect. Okay, so this is the mechanism of action of methyl dopa. Methyl dopa converts into the metabolites. Okay, this methyl dopa converts its metabolites, that is alpha methyl no methyl norepinephrine that stimulates the centrally inhibitory alpha adrenergic receptors that leads in the reduction in sympathetic tone, blood pressure, and the total peripheral resistance. Inhibition of decarboxylation of dihydroxyphenylalanine and 5-hydroxytryptophan in the CNS, which produces the antihypertensive effect. Let's see the method of synthesis, how we can synthesize this methyl dopamine hydrochloride. So in the syllabus, this is star drug. So we have to learn the synthesis of this drug. So 4-hydroxy-3-methoxy-phenylacetone is taken as starting material. Okay. So here 4-hydroxy-3-methoxy-phenylacetone we have taken. Okay. So this is the structure of 4-hydroxy-3-methoxy-phenylacetone. Okay. So this is the thing we have to take as the starting material. It undergoes reaction with ammonium chloride, followed by reaction with the potassium cyanide to alpha amino nitrile compound. So this reacted with ammonium chloride, okay, the NH4Cl. This is the ammonium chloride and the potassium cyanide. It undergoes reaction with ammonium chloride as well as the potassium cyanide. That when this reaction happens, we will get two amino 3-4-hydroxy 3-methoxy phenyl 2-methyl propen nitrile. Okay, so this product we will get after the reaction of these 4-hydroxy 3-methoxy phenyl acetone, when this reacted with ammonium chloride and the potassium cyanide, at that time we will get this product. Okay, so L-isomers is separated out of reaction with the camphosulfonic acid. Okay, camphosulfonic acid. So potassium cyanide to alpha amino nitrile compound. Okay, so this is the L-isomer. Okay, so this is the L-isomer of this methyl dopa, and this is reacted with the camphosulfonic acid. Okay, camphosulfonic acid and the sulfuric acids. When at that time we will get our product methyl dopa. So this is the synthesis of the methyl dopa. So we have to take first 4-hydroxy 3-methoxy phenylacetone, and this product undergoes reaction with the ammonium chloride and the potassium cyanide. At that time we will get 2-amino 3-4-hydroxy 4 3-methoxy phenyl 2-methyl propen nitrite. Okay, and when this product undergoes with, this is the L isomer. Okay, sorry, this is the L isomer. And when this when this reacted with the camphosulfonic acid and the sulfuric acid, we will get our product methyl dopa. So this is the synthesis of the methyl dopa we have to learn. So this is very important part of this topic, synthesis of the methyl dopa. Let's see the uses of this drug. So the drug is used in the treatment of high blood pressure, pregnancy induced hypertension, and the preeclampsia. So the methyl dopa, this is used for the treatment of high blood pressure and pregnancy induced hypertension, and in the preeclampsia. In this condition, we are using this methyl dopa. So let's see some MCQs regarding this topic. Impotence is most commonly caused by which antihypertensive agent? So that the correct answer is beta blockers. The optometrist diagnosed the patient with glaucoma. Which of the following drug is commonly used topically in the treatment of glaucoma? So the correct answer is timolol. An example of drug from class alpha to adrenergic agonist. So the correct answer is methyl dopa. The type of ring system found in the methyl dopa, is the correct answer is benzene ring. The correct order for the synthesis of drug methyl dopa can be. So first we have to take this 4-hydroxy 3-methoxy phenylacetone that is reacted with ammonium chloride. Okay. After that, this have to this, that when we get one product, okay? That product reacted with the camphor sulfuric acid and the potassium cyanide. Sorry. So, and that is reacted with the sulfuric acid to convert the cell isomer. So the correct answer is first, they have to, this the product have to react with ammonium chloride, then they have to react with potassium cyanide. After that, that is reacted with camphor sulfuric acid and reacted with the sulfuric acid. So this is the correct method of synthesis of the methyl DOPA. So these all are about the antihypertensive drugs. So thank you.